It's a story we've heard time and time again since Donald Trump took office about the hundreds of top-level posts across his administration that remain empty. Perhaps worse yet, those who have stepped in have absolutely no interest in learning from their predecessors how they should function. Here's what former EPA Administrator Gina McCarthy had to say when I asked her 7 months after Trump was sworn in about her offer to help her successor, Scott Pruitt, in the transition, as is a long-standing tradition.
Has he called you back yet?
Not yet, and I'm no longer holding my breath.
Of course, Pruitt is since out, leaving yet another unconfirmed placeholder in the top Trump administration ranks. So what does it mean for us that our government is being run by a group of people who don't believe in their agency's mission? That's one of the questions behind the new book. It's called The Fifth Risk. It's written by the best-selling author behind The Big Short, Blindside, and Moneyball, Michael Lewis, who joined me earlier today.
Michael, good to see you. Thanks so much for being here.
Pleasure.
So a story of those running government disrespecting the government they serve in. While Trump may have elevated that to an art form, it didn't start with Donald Trump, did it?
Oh, it didn't start with Trump. There's always been moments of kind of bumpy moments in transitions because the incoming people always feel a little contempt for the outgoing people. But there has been a tradition of the outgoing people sitting down with the incoming people across the administration,
like Gina McCarthy just said,
it's not just at the cabinet secretary level. The Obama administration deputed 1,000 people over the course of a year to prepare essentially what was the best course that's ever been created on how the federal government works in every department. So they're briefing books across the place,
and you were the first person to read some of those briefing books. Is that really true?
Not only is it true, they're still, because I only did 3 of the 15 departments. I'm sure most of the briefing books have not been opened.
You know, but I want to stay on history just for a second, because it seems that history was ready for Donald Trump and his people to disrespect the government. I'll tell you why I'm saying that. You're looking at me skeptically.
No, I
went to a Tea Party rally in Boston Common a bunch of years ago because I'd never seen Sarah Palin live. And the first thing I encounter is the infamous sign we've all seen on television: don't let government take over my Medicare. Right. So people were primed, either out of ignorance or anger, for this, weren't they, or no?
Yes. I mean, I think he is the kind of the end game for what Reagan started, the idea that government's not here to help you. But the degree of malice and neglect has never been anything like this.
Well, let's play off those malice and neglect. Was the motivation lack of interest, lack of knowledge, disdain, directions from above? Why the lack of interest in learning how the government you're running, no matter how you want to effectuate it, why the lack of interest in how it works?
I mean, that's a complicated question, I think, because at the first level, Trump turned to Chris Christie, who was supposed to be, he was in fact assembling a pretty good transition team during the campaign, and said, why are you doing that? And if we win, we can leave the victory party 2 hours early, and we're so smart, we can learn everything we need to know. So he had a level of arrogance about the whole thing. And then the day after the election, he fires the entire transition team. I think that it served his purposes for there to be chaos, for a couple of reasons. If there's not chaos, people who have a narrow financial conflict of interest get vetted out of the process. And a lot of those people have slipped into jobs they should not be in and are pursuing narrow financial interests inside the federal government. The second thing is, I don't know what he was hiding exactly about Russia and so on and so forth, but he was able to muddy the picture of his own dealings with Russia by putting certain people in certain places.
Well, some suggest that what he was hiding, now that we've learned from the New York Times that his father was bailing him out when his father wasn't there to bail him out anymore, maybe Russia was, no?
That's probably exactly what happened. Yeah. I mean, we know at the end of the 1980s that New York banks wouldn't lend him anymore, and his business was bankrupt. The question is, where did the money come from? And I mean, I think that's the biggest question at the center of Donald Trump's financial life.
Can I get back to the motive? I want to add one thing from reading your book late last night to the list, is shock. My favorite paragraph in the whole book is I think it's 1:35 in the morning when Pennsylvania comes in, and what's your line? It's like Trump is holding a pair of twos and someone calls his bluff.
This is the moment they realize they're going to win. Trump's going to be president. He had not written an acceptance speech. He had written a concession speech. Uh-huh. So they really didn't expect. The dog caught the car, and the dog doesn't know what to do when he got the car. Well, anyway, Mike Pence went to his wife, Karen Pence, and to give her a celebratory kiss and a hug, and she pushed him away, and she said, you got what you wanted, Mike. Leave me alone.
And she said, do you write after that, that she wouldn't even say hello? She had such contempt for Trump, she wouldn't even talk to him, wouldn't even say hello. Okay, so what's the consequence? I mean, people listening may say, okay, it's unfortunate, but, you know, government is imperfect. Talk about pick a department. I would pick energy, but you can pick whatever you want. Pick a department and talk about what the consequence of inattention, or whatever you want to call it, is for the American people.
All right. It's more than inattention. So broadly, the government manages a portfolio of all kinds of risks, and many of these are catastrophic risks. In the Energy Department, they manage the nuclear stockpile. Mm-hmm. So you would pick that, but let's probably pick something that's a little more subtle, but I think more interesting. Commerce Department is essentially a department of data. It runs a census, it collects the weather statistics, all the economic statistics. That's getting gummed up now in various ways. If we don't have a picture of who we are as a society, if we don't collect proper data about ourselves, the risks of that, what kind of risks do we run? The only reason we know there's an opioid crisis is because we collect prescription drug data and we made it available. There are all kinds of insidious things can happen in the society without us knowing if the data gets corrupted. And that worries me a lot because they don't care about facts. I think you can go in any department, I pick three, and you'd find a shocking story. And you'd say there is a serious risk here. Something really bad is going to happen that's been amplified.
What is by the way, you mentioned risk. What is the fifth risk? I should have asked you this earlier on for those who haven't
conceptually,
yet picked up
the book. Conceptually, the short answer is it's a risk that's really hard to imagine. You're moving through life and you're worried about three or four things. It's always the thing you're not thinking about that bites you. And there's so many things the government needs to be worrying about. And It's the thing that we're just not attending.
So you come in praise of public servants, which I love because I think it is long overdue. But I say to at the time that early President Trump was likening intelligence agencies to the Nazis, when he's trashing the people in the Department of Justice, what I think about all the time, we talk about on the radio almost every day, is does the average committed careerist, and I don't mean that in a pejorative way, I mean it in a loving way, in the government, do they become dispirited? Do they become angry and are ready to revolt against that? How do they react to that?
It's interesting, right? Because this is not a kind of person who's constitutionally predisposed to rebellion.
Right.
Right.
Course,
I mean,
he's
the kind of person who goes to work in government. They're not money driven. They're mission driven, and they are they follow orders. So what's happened? The first year of Trump, nearly 20% of the top 6,000 civil servants left. So that's what happens. What you're doing is seeing a draining of the government of these people.
And half of the top and half of the executive positions.
The political positions, the executive positions haven't been filled.
Can you talk a little, when I was reading about Ms. Finley at the end of your book, I think everybody knows a Ms. Finley. Maybe not the one, it's Oklahoma, right? Maybe not the one. Tell why you ended your book with Ms. Finley.
A tornado ripped through Elk City, Oklahoma a year ago. And she was a little old lady, and the tornado just took both barn and house, nothing there. And she luckily had gotten underground, thanks to the National Weather Service. When the FEMA people came back to assess the damages, she was waiting for them, and she says this odd thing to them. She says, I've prayed for 10 years for a tornado to come take that barn. I just didn't think it was going to take the house. And the FEMA guy says, you know, why would you pray for the tornado to take your barn? She said, my husband killed himself in that barn 10 years ago, and every time I pull into the driveway, I see it, and every time I pull out of the driveway, I see it, and I wanted the memory gone. I just didn't imagine it would take the house. And I thought, this is not a bad metaphor for the Trump voter, because they like the destruction. They imagine some specific destruction. They don't imagine the collateral damage from the destruction. They think that they're thinking it's going to take the barn, not the house.
Can we spend the last minute on the future? Are you hopeful, or is the damage irreversible?
Oh, no, the damage isn't irreversible. When I'm in a happy mood and I've got enough sleep, what I think is maybe he will wake the country up to what the government actually does. The country already had a dysfunctional relationship with its own government. The idea that it's something other, that it's not us, that it actually, it is not only a tool for solving big problems, it's the only tool we have for the biggest problems. I think it's enabled me to write a book about it that people are reading. So I couldn't have done that before him. So that's the bright side. The question is how long he's in there doing damage. And the longer he's there, the harder it is to fix.
I love the book. I can't wait to see if you can make this into a movie. I'll tell you, Michael, congratulations.
Thank you.
The book, again, is The Fifth Risk, and it is a truly fascinating read.